The topic is intravascular ultrasound in peripheral arterial disease. It's quite an important and very actual topic regarding the regarding the possibilities I see in the control screen, but not in the main one. So great, thank you so much. So nothing to declare regarding this topic. It's true that during the last years, the ultrasound-guided peripheral intervention is increasing in numbers. Let's look at the cardiology guidelines and what they say about IVUS utilization. In fact, during the last more than 15 years, the IVUS was used in order to elucidate the anatomy and to improve the results. And because of that, such methods like physiology assessment, like FFR, and imaging assessment like the IVUS and OCT, they found place in our cardiology coronary practice. And after more than 15 years of trials and evidence base, the IVUS was placed on a significant place in a coronary field. So the guidelines, the last guidelines in the European Society of Cardiology says the IVUS should be considered to assess the severity of unprotected left main lesions. Several trials, Japanese, Korean, international trials showed that IVUS definitely is improving the result of left main stenosis intervention. And also the recommendation tell us that IVUS should be considered to optimize treatment of unprotected left main lesions. And IVUS or OCT imaging, again, should be considered to detect stent-related mechanical problems leading to restenosis in order to improve the results. In fact, many trials and some meta-analysis unifying the data from many IVUS utilizing the trials showed that not only the stent restenosis and stent thrombosis is reduced, but in fact the IVUS imaging guidance is used to optimize stent implantation that is related to reduction of death, so reduction of mortality. There are just few of methods telling us reduction of mortality. And this is the reason the IVUS is in the cardiology guidelines as a very robust indication. No doubt, the IVUS ultrasound in cardiology has a huge role in our daily practice. But in fact, in peripheral arterial disease, we still don't have guidelines, but we have an increasing practice to utilize the IVUS. And I was very happy to show the presentation of Professor Shimokawahara, showing that the results, even with balloon angioplasty in CTEPH, are best with the IVUS utilization. And not only, this is not the only field, not only the field of pulmonary circulation is used. Carotid intervention, in many cases, in many complex cases, peripheral vascular and especially total occlusions. Again, the Japanese guys started as a first tool in order to optimize and to improve the probability of recanalization in OCT and not only. So, what about imaging and diagnostic as a diagnostic tool? We had to take a look better at the plaque morphology, vessel diameter. It's clear since more than year, 10 years that the vessel diameter is wall-to-wall, is best measured by the IVUS. Vessel lumen and presence of arterial dissections, I will show you a specific case in several minutes. And I mentioned already that the IVUS is used as an additional tool for intervention. This is for stent sizing, for crossing total occlusion to increase the probability of recanalization, assessing residual narrowing, and also assessing especially restenosis, not only instant, but after balloon angioplasty restenosis. It's quite long to mention all the vascular territories, but it's true, in all vascular territory, IVUS can be used for different kind of also intervention, like EVER, TEVER, carotid artery, subclavian, vena cava, superficial femoral artery, and so on. Based on the Israeli experience, it's clear that the angio, in fact, the angiography is a quite not precise method tool, imaging method to depict the real anatomical situation. It's like a luminography, but in fact, it's not. It's a shade of a lumen. So because of that, the angio doesn't serve very well or at all to take a look at the plaque morphology, to if there is a thrombus there or not, is there a dissection, what kind the extrinsic compression, in case we have a suspicion about extrinsic compression. Of course, the biggest advantage is the flow, so the visualization of the flow. In all the other scenario, IVUS is better. And because of that, in the publication, IVUS is, in fact, not only promoted, but it's proven to improve the results, to see better the dissections during post-atherectomy devices utilization and plain balloon angioplasty. And we know still that there are some vessel territories in which the plain balloon angioplasty is still method of choice. And because of that, we have to take a look, second look, in order to decide to stent or not to stent, and what kind of device to use in order to have better results. So all these trials are showing, very recent trials are showing, that IVUS can optimize the results of the intervention, not only into the arterial, but also into the venous part of the vasculature. IVUS can help us to improve visualization and hence improve results. So, in a systematic review, there are many meta-analyses and systematic reviews showing how important is the IVUS to improve the results, to better look and achieve better results in different clinical and anatomical scenarios. So in all this situation, we have to, especially in complex and complicated cases, the IVUS can be definitely a very good tool in order to improve the results in our patient. I will speak about a specific particular device, and this is the Kodama device by Bracco. Kodama, by the way, in Japanese, is a small ghost, small, tiny, and very sympathetic ghost that is very positive, and probably from there is coming the name. About the IVUS technology, years and many years behind, more than 40 years behind. But during the last several years, there is no more improvement into the IVUS field. So the OCT is giving better visualization, better resolution, and so on. So the Kodama is on the market since not very long, and definitely it's a good improvement of the old technology. In many ways, it's very versatile because it's one catheter for all, because the frequency can be adjusted. So depending on the frequency, we have different range. High frequency, lower range, but very good visualization and very good resolution. Lower frequency, higher range. And because of that, the catheter, this IVUS catheter, that is rapid exchange, by the way, and it's over all 14 wire, can be used both in coronary and peripheral vessels up to the aorta. even up to the aorta. So it's a very user-friendly, touch screen, one screen only, one console, that is the interconnector between the screen and the catheter itself. Extremely, in not more than 2 minutes, the catheter is loaded onto the console, so it's very, very, very user-friendly. And I mentioned already that it's a touchscreen device to be manipulated with. And we have in one and the same simultaneous longitudinal and perpendicular visualization. And by the touchscreen, we have several options in order to take better the lumen, thrombus, or to take better picture of the vessel wall. So with just a click, we can emphasize visualization of the wall or visualization of the lumen. There is an automatic high-speed pullback, but also with manual pullback, it's absolutely possible to be utilized. These are the three: lumen view, silk view, and classic view, in order to make transversal and longitudinal visualization of the lumen and the vessel wall. So, this is the catheter itself. I mentioned already, it's a rapid exchange. Early after the tip, there is the port for the wire. The catheter is extremely flexible, low profile, three French, in fact, it's six French guiding catheter, coronary guiding catheter compatible, and because of that, it can be used also for coronary circulation. It provides really easy navigation in tortuous anatomies because above everything, it's very, very flexible, and we can go almost everywhere with this new catheter. What I'm saying, you see, these are the features of the catheter itself. It's the distal tip is 2 French, otherwise the crossing profile is 3.5, and it's largely compatible with the 6 French. And this is the assist new system between dual frequency, you see, 40 and 60 megahertz, and I mentioned already what is the meaning of that. I'm showing several cases. The first case that I wanted to show is from today. It's a 68-year-old female with a very short claudication. And this is the crossover, typical crossover approach from the right femoral to the left. A lot of calcium you see here. And the lady is a smoker and not so elevated LDL cholesterol. But for this lesion of the femoral artery, that was probably, I will try to stop. Could you help me with stopping? No? Okay, let's play it again. I will show you the stenosis once again. Okay. Please take a look and here, you see, there is a gap. So it's a short occlusion of the vessel. Short occlusion, probably relatively recent because she's symptomatic, severely symptomatic since 1 month. So we decided to avoid dissection. You know that one of the Achilles heel of the balloon angioplasty is a dissection. In this situation, we have used the so-called chocolate balloon. That is a special type of like a scoring balloon that is redistributing the radial pressure of the balloon. So this is the chocolate balloon, 5, and we checked after the 5 millimeter after the first chocolate 5 millimeter balloon, and you see. You saw probably the dissection flap. It was very tiny, not very extensive dissection flap, but there is still a residual stenosis. So this is distal. You see still there is a residual stenosis from here to here to here is the vessel wall. So we can do better. So we put the second chocolate 5 by 80 millimeter again. And for our big surprise, we saw not only that the lumen increased, but even the small dissection almost disappeared. So we improved the result with improving the lumen. You see, the vessel is very, very, very good. And we finished the procedure with the drug coating balloon in order to improve probably in the future the result. And this is the result to reduce the probability of restenosis. This is the final peripheral artery result. Another case, also very interesting, but another vascular territory. This is a carotid. The patient is 74-year gentleman with right internal carotid 50% stenosis and subtotal left internal carotid stenosis. And unfortunately, the right vertebral artery was totally thrombosed. Fortunately, the left vertebral artery was absolutely fine. So you see a critical symptomatic stenosis, and we decided to take a look at this very critical stenosis. We saw that there is on the IVUS, there is a combination of calcium-containing, fibrotic and thrombus-containing lesion. That is absolutely logic in case of such a critical carotid stenosis. So in this particular case, we had to use a special technique, the so-called deep loop, in which the guiding sheet that we are using in more than 99% of the cases, a guiding sheet, the so-called deep loop was due to the type 3 aortic arch that is quite difficult to use the femoral approach in type 3 aortic arch because the left carotid artery is very difficult to be cannulated, and it's extremely easy to be visualized, but to cannulate with the international guiding catheter or sheet, it's quite difficult. So we used the technique of deep loop cannulation, so sitting on the non-coronary cusp of the aortic valve, sitting there. The good news that the left internal common carotid artery, in case of type 3 aortic arch, is like a direct continuation of the ascending aorta. So it's relatively easy sitting on the aortic cusp to cannulate the carotid artery. And after taking a look by the IVUS and putting the distal protection, we implanted, after a small balloon predilation, we implanted a closed cell design stent because of the thrombus-containing lesion in order to reduce the probability of distal embolization. This is the final result by angio, and the final result by the IVUS showing very good apposition of the stent. You see how dense is the mesh of the closed cell design stent. That was an excellent demonstration of the IVUS in this particular case. So you see the deep sitting and going into the carotid artery, and this is the removal. By the way, the removal, it's better to remove the sheet and the guiding catheter with the protection of on the tip with a wire, because sometimes when we remove, the catheter can go very deeply and can damage the vessel. As a take-home message, I would say that the IVUS is the ideal imaging tool to help guide peripheral endovascular procedure. It's the IVUS-related complications with the utilization of such a low-profile, very flexible device is very with very low probability. And IVUS improves plaque understanding of the disease vessel and allows better planning in order to improve the result and reduce the probability of complication. And thank you very much for your attention. Comments on questions?
Ivo.
Yeah.
I know you do a large number of type B aortic dissection. Do you use IVUS?
In several instances, we have used the IVUS, especially to decide how to cross from the Faust to the true lumen and to decide if we are into the right lumen. And definitely, it's very helpful. And also, once we have used the IVUS to see the inferior vena cava, quite big thrombus that was not very well seen by the CT, by the CTA. And in both cases, it's very helpful. So, like I mentioned, because this assist device is with differential frequency, it can be switched from small vessel to big vessels. And even for dissection, it's even better because you can go within a vessel, branch vessel, that is involved by the dissection, in order, because we have, like in your practice as well, in many cases, in order to improve the distal flow into the true lumen, aortic true lumen, we have to stent the branch vessels, the true lumen in order to improve the flow and to fix the membrane. So you know that branch vessel many times are divided between the true and the false lumen. In this situation, the IVUS is definitely very, very useful tool.